just pray that you continue to use the songs that we sing. Allow us to listen to the words. Allow us to be led to your throne. I thank you for this answer of prayer all week long. And this Tina lady that just had a move of you in her life. And it's because we took the boldness. We took the courage to step out and to lift these people up. We took the courage to put you first in our life. I just pray that you'd help us to seek you and to find you everywhere we go. In Jesus' name I pray, and all God's people said,
great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinners. Restless
Lord, we bless you in this place. And Lord, we just ask right now as we take up this offering, Lord, that the money that's brought in today, Lord, would go to further your kingdom in this region, in this city. Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit would fall in this place today. Lord, that you would move in a mighty way, Lord. And I just thank you for everyone that's here. Lord, we pray that this morning would be a blessing to you, Jesus, and you alone. And so we love you, Lord, as we give this tithe and offering to you, Jesus, that you would bless. That you would bless this house. In Jesus' name, amen.
Take me back to where it all began, where all I ever wanted was your presence. How I long to be there once again. Light a fire that the world can't burn out, fan the flame till nothing between us remains. My life is an altar to you. Breathe again on the embers that burn in my heart. A love taken back to the start. Take me back to where it all began. Before it all became so complicated. How I long to be there once again. Till nothing between us remains. My life is an altar to you. Breathe again. Oh. Light a fire that the world can't burn out, fan the flame till nothing between us remains. My life is an altar to you. Breathe again on the embers that burn. My life is an altar to you.
And I cast my mind Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all. Return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on my Jesus' face, and I'll praise his name. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Oh, praise your name forever, Jesus. We'll praise your name forever, Lord. Can you imagine that day, church? Oh, can you imagine that day? Imagine the day. when you're filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea, when you know everything, and our God dwells with us, and he will be our people, or we will be his people, and he will be our God. Can you imagine the day when he is the light within our midst? When we finally see the Son ascended to the throne, when we see the broken and slain Lamb reigning on high at the right hand of the Father, when we look upon the one that we have pierced, oh Lord, the glory of you enthroned. And when John saw it, he fell at his feet as a dead man. Oh Lord, would you pierce our hearts with your gaze like you pierced John? That we might come into the knowledge of you and your glory, Lord. When we see your glory, Jesus, what else is there? Worthy are you, Lord. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, and worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Lord, you're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath I could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are, and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath I could ever breathe. Oh, I live for you. I live for you, Jesus. Jesus, the name every other name, no other. Jesus, the only one who could ever save me. You're worthy of every breath I could ever breathe. I live for you. Oh, my King, I live for you. You're holy, holy, holy. There is no one like you. There is no you're holy. You are holy and you are worthy of all of our praise. Did you know there's only one word, one attribute of the Lord that's ever repeated to the third degree in the Bible? Is it just? It's not just. The Lord isn't just, just, just. He's not grace, 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 although he is those things. But the Bible says that he is holy, holy, holy. Oh, Lord, you are holy, holy, holy above all things, Father. Yes, praise him for his holiness. He is concerned about about how we treat his name. He is concerned about his holiness, church. And that holy God was made flesh to die for you, to be made your chief cornerstone. But you built your life upon him this morning, upon him who is the way, the truth, and the life. There is no other foundation that is strong enough. Oh, Jesus, only you. I will build my life.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. And I will put my trust in you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. I bless you, Father. I bless you, Father, for the works of your hand, Father. The Lord has bared his holy arm in the sight of all the nations, and the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our Lord. Praise him, for he has done a great thing for us. Bless you, Father.
And death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory. For you have raised to life again. You have Nothing can stand against what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. There is no other name, Lord. Father, there is no other name by which we are saved. No other name by which we are delivered. We are redeemed. We are washed clean. Though our sins were like scarlet, you've washed us white as snow. So, Lord, we offer ourselves up to you this morning as a living sacrifice. Holy Spirit, would you fill us? Would you guide our lives? We build our lives on you, God. We build our lives on your promises, on your faithfulness, on the truth of Jesus, the Son, the Christ. And we long to do your will, Lord. We long to exalt you, to enthrone you on our praises. So, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to come together and sing praises to you, to position our hearts in a posture of praise and thanksgiving for your goodness, Lord. And as this word comes forth, Lord, would you just prepare the soil? Would you prepare the soil, Lord? Lord, that we could reap what you sow. We trust you. We trust you, Lord. And we love you and we thank you for this time. Amen.
Have a seat. Good morning. I'm Pastor Phil from Lakeland Baptist Church in Carbondale, and I want to bring you greetings from my in-laws. Some of you may know them, Jack and Ava Shelby. They surrendered to missions in this church back in about 1956 or 57, something like that. And they've been at our house for the last 4.5 years. I used to say I had the best in-laws in the world because they disappeared for 4 years out of five, and they only came home once a year, one year out of five. And then they not only came home and retired, they came home and now they're living with us. I got my answer. Best in-laws in the world, and glad that they can live with us in their last years before they go to be with Jesus. It's been a blessing to have them. Jack is he's failing health-wise. Both of them are a little bit. Jack's had many, many strokes, so he's pretty much confined to our house. He's not lost his sense of humor. My mother-in-law has. She doesn't laugh at any of my jokes. But I have learned a way to get rid of my mother-in-law. I just pull out my joke book, and she ends up disappearing into the bedroom. So we have a great time at our house, and I have 7 kids. Jack and Ava have 9 grandchildren and 17 great-grandchildren, so they're able to enjoy most of them because they live pretty close to us in this place. So it's my pleasure and my joy to be with you this morning. My desire this morning is that out of this message, you'll become a house of prayer. My desire this morning is many of you are going to sign up and say, I won't do anything but pray. I'm going to give my life to prayer. The one thing God calls his church to be is a house of prayer, and for some reason we've missed that. We think it's a house of preaching, and we brag about how long our sermons can go, and My sermons can go pretty long. I got the second service today, so they say there's no exit point here, so I can go for a couple hours if I want to, just to warn you about that. All right, great. I've got his opinion. I've got his permission, so hang on for lunch until about 2:30 or 3. But the one thing Jesus said, his house is to be his house of prayer. And why is it we have so much difficulty doing that? Because the enemy knows that if we get that, he's lost. I love what Samuel Chadwick says about prayer. He says, Satan dreads nothing but prayer. He fears activities are multiplied and organizations are increased that prayer may have no chance. Satan dreads nothing but prayer. He does not fear our prayerless religion, our prayerless work, and our prayerless toil. He mocks at our wisdom. He laughs at our toil, but he trembles when we pray. Now, today we're going to look at Luke chapter 11, verse 1 and 2. I'm going to do a verse and a half. It'll take me about 45 minutes to get through a verse and a half. Aren't you glad I'm not doing the whole chapter? All right? Now, we got to go back up. We didn't reset this since last service, so give me a few moments to do this. Here we go. In Luke chapter 11, verse 1, we find Jesus and his disciples at the Garden of Gethsemane. They'd been to Mary and Martha's house. They'd just been there for a couple days, and they've left from Mary and Martha's house in Bethany and done about a mile and a half walk to get in the Garden of Gethsemane. This is the time when Jesus is about 4.5 to 5 months away from his crucifixion. This prayer that we see recorded in Luke chapter 11 is not the same prayer that Jesus gave the disciples in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 6. It's different by a lot. Number one, it's only got 60 words. The Sermon on the Mount prayer has 101. There's a lot of other changes, and we'll look at that in a minute. But we're going to ask this question. The disciples had been following Jesus now for 2.5 years. And it says here, one day Jesus was praying in a certain place. We know the certain place because the Bible tells us when he gets close to Jerusalem, his certain place was always the Garden of Gethsemane. So they've walked up, and the disciples have watched, but he's praying away by himself privately. But the disciples are watching. And Luke gives us that kind of inside track of what's taking place here. They're watching, and when he comes out, his disciples followed him, and when he comes out, we're going to go back here. We're going to understand that this prayer experience with Jesus is not some mythical story. The account that Luke gives us in Luke is not some nice myths that don't happen. These are actual historical events. And this is what Luke says in Luke chapter 1, verse 3 through 4. He says, "Therefore, since I myself have carefully investigated everything from the beginning, it seemed good also to me to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the certainty of the things you've been taught." Luke has given us a historical rendition, a historical record of what actually took place when Jesus was doing public ministry. Now, there's a guy called by the name of William Ramsey. He was an archaeologist, and he had some real problems with Luke, because he didn't like Jesus. And he thought he could disprove the Gospels because Luke records some things that nobody else in his time period does. In specific, one title he uses is the title of Polytarchs in Thessalonica. That's a term nobody else in that first century writing ever referred to as a title. And so William Ramsey says this guy's off his rocker. He's made some very gross historical errors. If I can prove he's not historical, I can discount the Gospels. So he goes to Asia Minor to disprove it. In his archaeological digs in around Thessalonica, he finds the title Polytarchs 5 different times. And every time he tries to find something that's wrong geographically, he finds out Luke records stuff that nobody else records, and he discovers that in the archaeological record. He thereby reaches the conclusion that Luke is an historian of the first rank, which means when he writes something down, you could count it as actually happening. So all the miracles we find in Luke, historically verified. All the things that Jesus said, historically verified. Every place he went to, historically verified. So this is an actual event. The disciples are now watching Jesus in the garden about 4.5 to 5 months before he's crucified. And they watch him. And you got to ask the question now, wonder what they saw. What did they see Jesus do? Now, the garden account, we see a couple things. When he goes in the garden the last time, and at the end of the Gospel of Luke, in Luke chapter 22, it says he began kneeling. Matthew and Mark says he fell face on the ground. When he went into that garden, he began to agonize. But he didn't just agonize in the garden right before the cross. He agonized in many other ways. We'll see this in just a minute. In Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7, the writer of Hebrews says, during the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. So if you're to listen into Jesus' prayer time with the Father, I don't know where we got this word quiet time from. I have no idea, because this was not a quiet time. When Jesus the Son went in before the Father at the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, God, help! That was his regular posture. He offered up loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. Because if he sinned in one little half a second, he would not be a sufficient Savior. If he was anxious in one little moment, he couldn't be a sufficient Savior. If he prayed for somebody to be healed and they weren't healed, he was not a sufficient Savior. As a matter of fact, he tells the disciples in John chapter 5, verse 19, he says, I tell you the truth, the Son can do nothing of himself. He can only do what he sees the Father doing. So what Jesus had to do in his prayer life with the Father, he had to be so in tune with the Father, he had to know exactly what the Father was going to do, and he had to hit it spot on 100% of the time, or he's not a sufficient Savior. So when he goes into the garden, his cry is, God, please, Father, please show yourself so I can be the sufficient Savior. And the disciples are watching outside. He had a certain place. They knew where to find him. Almost every time he disappeared, they knew exactly where to find him. Mark chapter 1, verse 35, it says, Jesus rose up a great while before morning and went to a solitary place and there prayed. And then the disciples went out to look for him. They knew exactly where to find him. And when they found him in that time of prayer in Mark chapter 1, they said, Jesus, the whole world is looking for you. And he says, good, let's go someplace else because that's where I've come. The whole world's looking for you. He said, I'm not going where the crowd wants me. I'm going where somebody else needs me. He understood he's not to gain a crowd following. He's to be the sufficient Savior. In Luke chapter 5, verse 15 and 16, when they found him during the day, busy time of ministry, he's often withdrawing to lonely places and praying. During the ministry, during the busy, hectic time of his ministry, he's always finding time to get away with the Father. Let me ask you a question. In your hectic schedule, do you have behind, in the back of your mind, working all the time, Father, I love you. I can't wait to see what you're going to do in this situation. I'm anxious. You tell me not to be anxious, so I'm coming to you right now because you say if I bring everything to you with prayer and petition with thanksgiving, that your peace will guard my heart. Do you live with a constant awareness of his presence in the back of your mind? You know, I've been married 43 years, 43 and a half. I've given my wife lots of reasons not to be married to me. I'm not the nicest guy to be married to and late at night sometimes. But you know what happens because of the love my wife has for me? You know what goes on in my mind all the time? I'm constantly thinking about her in the back of my mind. She's not far from my mind. Now, here's the question I want to ask you. Is your love for Jesus transcend that? Do you find you're thinking about Jesus all the time? When you walk to the grocery store and you're wondering, am I going to pay the bill because the food prices have just gone through the roof? Are you finding yourself rejoicing in God because that's what he wants you to do? Are you finding yourself praying constantly because you can't help but be in love with God and you can't help talking about him with everybody that comes in contact with you? See, if you're not a person of prayer, that won't happen. Won't happen. Jesus says, I'm the vine and you're the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, the same brings forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. Now see, if you're not abiding in Christ and you're accomplishing things, all you're doing is making a big pile of nothing. That's it. If you're not falling in love with Jesus and he's not the first thought and the last thought and the in-between thought, you're just accomplishing a bunch of nothing. Jesus has to be our first response and our last resort. He has to be the one we talk to when we first get out of bed. He has to be the last thought when we go to sleep at night. He has to be the one that guides our dreams and lives in our dreams and speaks to us even as we sleep. Why waste 8 hours a day sleeping when God can teach us through our dreams? When's the last time you've asked God to speak to you as you dream? It's cool to do that. You won't waste your dreams that way. Now, reasons to know how to pray. I want you to notice something in this text. The disciples say, Lord, teach us to pray. They don't teach us to pray about this. They don't say, teach us how to pray. He's already done that 2.5 years ago in the Sermon on the Mount. They got the message. 2.5 years ago, this is the kind of pattern you're supposed to pray after. They don't say, teach us a prayer to pray. They say, teach us to pray. Now it's the command. It's not a request. I want you to think about this for a minute, because John the Apostle comes to Jesus when he's coming out of that garden in Luke chapter 11, and he says, Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples to pray. That word teach is not a, it's not a request. It's a command. Now, I want you to think about this. When have you ever commanded God to do anything? That's pretty hard to think you could command God to do something, isn't it, young lady? It is. But here's what God says in Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 22. We can find it out here. It says, the Lord said to me, you have seen correctly, and I'm watching to see that my word is fulfilled. He's talking to Jeremiah. You've seen correctly, Jeremiah, and I'm watching to see that my word is fulfilled. He's saying, I've given you promises in the scripture. I want you to claim them and trust me to fulfill those for you. Now, anybody want to care to guess? If you were here in the first service, no fear to answer this one. Anybody care to guess how many promises God has given us in the scripture to claim? There's 31,102 verses of scripture. How many of those verses are promises for us to claim? Anybody know? How many say there's at least 100? How many say there are at least 100 promises? How many think there's at least 1,000 promises? Okay? Anybody think there's more than 1,000 promises? How many think there's 2,000 promises? How many think there's 3,000 promises? How many think there's 4,000? Anybody think there's 4,000? That's 1 out of 7 verses is a promise. How many think there's that many promises? How many think there's more than 5,000 promises? How many think there's more than 6,000 promises? There's 6,152 specific promises that you can claim in prayer. Now, here's what happens when we go to prayer. When we show up at prayer meetings, you know what we do? We pray for grandma's toes because they got corns and calluses. Oh, I'll pray for those. That's not first priority, though. God does care about grandma's toes. He cares about my feet. My feet are ugly. He cares about my feet. He said, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. I like to say, take off my shoes and let my kids see my goofy fungus toes. And I said, Jesus says they're beautiful. You know why? Because I preach the gospel. I don't care what your toes look like. I don't care how many warts or calluses you got on them. If you're preaching the gospel, Jesus says you got good looking feet. Wow. I like that. Now, promises to claim. When you come to prayer, how long does your prayer meeting last before you run out of promises? Most Baptist prayer meetings, about 15 minutes. Last Saturday night, we had an incredible experience at Mardi Gras. And I want to say something just real quickly. Your church has been so gracious to allow us to use your bus. I don't know how many years it's been, probably 7, 8 years. I don't know how long. But that bus was a marvelous tool for God to use in ministry at Mardi Gras. But God, in his sovereign ordination, decided to have it break down in Memphis. And there's a reason he did that. Let me tell you the reason. You see, most of our men, most of the church in America, don't know how to pray. We just don't. We come, we'll sit in front of the church or sit in a prayer meeting, and within 5 minutes we've gone to, oh God, bless my sister, bless my brother, help me have good food tomorrow. And we don't know how to pray powerful prayers, because we don't know the promises of God. And so God wanted to teach our men at Mardi Gras how to pray. And so God ordered the bus to break down in Memphis. So on Saturday night, we were thinking about taking all 54 guys to the street. We couldn't. It'd take up the whole night, so we could only take half. So we, as a leadership team, we got together and said, what are we going to do? I said, listen, I believe God wants us to have half of them stay back here. We're going to pray. And we're going to pray the whole time the other team's out. And they looked at me like I was crazy. I said, but wait a minute. You understand why, if God's ordering every event and he orders even the machine of the bus to break down, he did that for a reason. What's the reason? He's calling us to prayer, men and women. When things break down in your life, when your house breaks down, when your air conditioning breaks down, when your finances fail, what's he calling you to do? Not to worry. He's calling you to cry out to him. When the country falls apart, what's he calling the church to do? And I want to tell you, we failed the COVID test. We did. There are two things the Lord wants us to do as a church. Talk openly and unashamedly about the gospel. And number two, become a house of prayer for all nations. When COVID hit, you know what we did? We sheltered in our homes. We got afraid to tell anybody about Jesus. and our prayer meetings became non-existent. We failed miserably. There won't be another time to pass a test. He's going to give us another one, and it's coming quickly. And we better be a house of prayer. We better know the promises of God, because if we don't, we'll fail that again, and I don't think there'll be another time to come back. I really don't believe that. I believe God's called us to be a house of prayer, and he's ordering the events of our life right now to prepare us to be exactly that. So, Jeremiah 1:12, Jesus says, God says, I'm watching over my word to fulfill it, to perform it. Here's my promises, Jeremiah. Now, go ahead and trust me with these promises and see if I don't answer. Let's go back to Exodus chapter 32, 9 through 14. This is a place where Moses is specifically told by God to not do something. And Moses directly disobeys a command from God. Let's see what happens. Exodus 32, verse 9 through 14, we're looking at. This is when Moses was on top of the mountain for 40 days, and while he's up on the top of the mountain getting the 40 commandments. I forgot, I've got 40 commandments. God's only got 10. There are 10 commandments. And while he's up there, the nation of Israel is down at the bottom committing all sorts of pagan revelry. And God tells Moses, this is what he says. I've seen these people, the Lord said to Moses. They're a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone so that my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them. Then I'll make of you into a great nation. Now wait a minute. Hear what he just said? Leave me alone and I'll make of you a great nation. I'll destroy them and make you a great nation. Now if you were Moses and you were in the presence of God on the top of the mountain and there's thunder and lightning and earthquake and all over the place, and he says, don't talk to me about Israel again, what would you be most likely to do? You probably wouldn't want to talk to him about Israel again because he just told you not to. How could you dare defy God on the top of Mount Sinai when he expressly told you not to talk to him about Israel? Let's see what Moses does. But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. O Lord, he said, why should your anger burn against your people whom you brought out of Egypt with great power and mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountain, to wipe them off the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce anger, relent, and do not bring disaster on your people. Notice the word turn is in italics. That's a command. That's not a request. Moses is going right back into the face of God. When God has told him, don't talk to me about Israel anymore, Moses goes right back and says, God, you can't do that. Now turn from your destruction. Don't do that because you can't. Anybody bold like that in the presence of God here? Anybody have the audacity to have that kind of boldness? You know why we don't? Because we don't know the promises. We don't know what God has said. Now, watch this. Moses says, remember your servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self. I'll make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky. I'll give your descendants all this land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever. Notice what Moses does in verse 13. God, the reason you can't do that is remember your promise. And Titus chapter 1, verse 2 says, in the hope of eternal life, that God promised who cannot lie. If we find out what God's promised, we take the promise right back to him and say, God, you promised. You can't do that. When's the last time you've taken the promise of one of your lost relatives and pleaded with him? The very promise when he says, I'm not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. Now, some of you might be reformed in here and might think God's already ordained all the elect from the beginning of the world. I won't argue that point. But here's what I will argue. God says, you take my word and you test my word and trust my word and cry out to him because he says he'll do it. And here's what I know. In the 47 years of ministry I've been alive, here's what I know. I've never heard a story of somebody who's prayed consistently day in and day out for years for somebody to come to faith in Christ, that God has not answered their prayer. Now, there might be one, but I've not heard of one. If you're concerned about the salvation of some of your friends and loved ones, then you start right now interceding for them and praying for them that the Spirit of God would fall in their lives and break their hard heart apart and cause them to repent and come to Jesus. Now, question. When are you most like Jesus? Now, you know, the kids did some nice food distribution today, and you'd say, you know, that's when we're most like Jesus, when we're caring for others, social justice ministries. Those are cool, right? Is that when we're most like Jesus? Maybe we're most like Jesus when we're given a lot of money so the church ministry can go on. That might be when we're most like Jesus. Well, I want to suggest to you today the reason, the place where most like Jesus gives the answer in two specific scripture references. Romans chapter 8, verse 34 says, who is he that condemns? Jesus Christ, who is raised to the who has died more than that, was raised to life, is also at the right hand of God, making intercession for them. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25 says, Jesus is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, because he ever lives to make intercession for them. When are you most like Jesus? When you're interceding before the Father for somebody to come to Christ. That's when you're most like Jesus. When you're most like Jesus, when you're interceding for your city to have revival, the Spirit of God to fall on them, and you won't quit till revival comes. My deep concern is we haven't prayed for revival like we should. That's why God hasn't answered. Why should he answer if we don't ask? Jesus says, ask and you'll receive, seek and you'll find, knock and the door will be opened unto you. That's a present tense verb that means you keep doing it till he shows up. We used to have revival back in the late 1800s, early 1900s. We got revival back then by praying and fasting. Now we pray fast and think God's going to answer. You know, there's some questions the disciples asked Jesus when he was here in the Gospels. One of those questions was, why did they say Elijah must come first? Another question was, how do you explain this parable of the sower to us? Another question is, what's the sign of your coming? Another question is, are you going to restore the kingdom now to Israel? And one of the questions was, why could we not cast him out? And Jesus says in Mark 9:29, this kind comes out only by prayer and fasting. When's the last time you've had a prayer and fasting meeting for the church? We started doing some at Lakeland 3 years ago. We don't get a lot of attendance for it, but we call it an all-church prayer summit. We go up to Lake Saltiska and rent out the whole Saltiska, and there's 16 hotel rooms. There's 18 people that show up. Every one of them have a prayer room. We give them assignments. They go into those prayer rooms, and they pray for 4, 5, 6 hours over Friday night and Saturday morning. And every member that's gone to those comes back and said, I've never had anything like that in my life. I'm calling you to prayer. I'm calling you to fast. I'm calling you to cry out to God, to be a church that, first of all, is on its knees advancing. That prayer has opportunity here and access to you. Now, notice what God does in verse 14. Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened. What caused God to change his mind about bringing disaster on the nation of Israel? Was he not going to do it anyway? Well, then it makes nonsense for him to tell Moses, leave me alone. What moved the heart of God? God was moved by Moses' prayer, taking his word for what it meant. Now, I know that causes all sorts of theological questions for all of us. But I'd rather be on the inside intercession crying out for God to move than trying to figure out theologically which one makes sense or not. God says you have not because you ask not. We haven't asked. Now, I want you to notice a couple other things. Why did the disciples want Jesus to teach them to pray? Their question was, it was not a question, it was a command, but it was a statement, teach us to pray. They didn't say teach us how to pray. They said teach us to pray. Now, just for a moment, again, no hands raised. That doesn't happen in Baptist churches anyway, I know that, okay? But this is what I want you to think about. How many of you struggle with this thing called prayer? How many find, okay, you've made your mind up today, you might even make a decision at the end of the service, okay, tomorrow when I wake up, I'm going to pray. First thing I'm going to pray, I'm seek the heart of my God. And then tomorrow morning wakes up, and guess what happens? The alarm doesn't go off at the right time. Kids are wailing and screaming. There's snow on your ice, on your windshield. You go out and scrape that. The car doesn't start. And you think, well, I can't pray now because look at all this. The enemy will fight you. Once you decide to set prayer as your priority, he'll send every one of his arsenals against you to stop you in your tracks because he knows the power that you have in prayer. Amen. Jeremiah, call unto me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things you don't yet know. Daniel chapter 9, when Daniel opens the Bible as he was prone to do every day, he's reading from the Old Testament prophet Jeremiah. And it's Daniel chapter 9, verse 1. It says, I, Daniel, in the first year of Darius, I understood to the prophet Jeremiah the captivity of Jerusalem was going to last 70 years. The first year of Darius was the 69th year of the captivity. So then what did Daniel do based on that information from Jeremiah the prophet, chapter 25 through 29? Hey, in 1 year's time, we're going home. So what do you need to do if you're going to go home? You got to get ready. And he got ready through prayer and fasting and confession and repentance. People, I want to tell you, in a few short months, maybe a year or two, maybe 3 years, we're going home. Some of you are going to go home a lot sooner than that, I can tell. Because some of you are a lot older than I am. And I could go home before I finish this sentence. I live with that constant awareness. I could go home at this very moment. Before I finish this sentence, I could be standing before God. And I want the last words on my lips to say, to be this: you need Jesus. I want that to be the last speech I preach. We live with that constant awareness that we'd be going home. So if we're going home, let's get ready. We get ready through prayer and fasting. We get ready through repentance. And what would happen if the church purified herself through prayer and fasting and repentance? What would God do in this city if you guys decided to do that here at Dorsville? Way more than you can imagine. Amen. That's what he says in Ephesians chapter 2, chapter 3, verse 20. Unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundant above all that we can ask or imagine. Wow. All right. And just to let you think, just to help you think this, this is what Jesus tells us in John 14 in his upper room discourse. He tells his disciples in John 14, 12, truly I say to you, you're going to do greater works than I do because I'm going to my Father. And I will do these greater works through you because the Father will be glorified in the Son. So if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Now, tell those who have this feeling that the word Jesus, some magical formula we use at the end of a prayer, that's not what it means. It doesn't mean say in Jesus' name at the end of your prayer and that's going to be the answer. When it says to pray in Jesus' name, it means this. It means to pray in a way that rightly represents God's character and nature and desire. So when you find out what God's plan is and God's purpose is, you ask according to that, and he answers, he says, if you ask in my name in a way that rightly represents me, I'll do it. You just have to ask. Wow. Why is it our prayer lives are so feeble and so weak? Because we don't know the word. We don't know the word. You know, Hosea chapter 4, verse 6 says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Lack of knowledge. God says you got the whole thing in front of you. But so few of us ever know what it says. We let the preacher know it. That wasn't God's design. His design was that you knew it and walked with it. I'll never forget when I was in Russia back in 1996. It's when Michael Jordan was the playing for the Bulls at the time for the playoffs. The national championship was on the line. We were under house arrest in Moscow. We were told we couldn't talk about Jesus or we'd be arrested. So we're waiting to go home. And a bunch of these guys on the mission team, they're all from Southern Illinois, about 29 Baptists. They're all gathered in this room, and it's a little black and white TV. It's got a fuzzy screen. You can hardly see what's playing. You can hardly hear the sportscasters, but it was the Chicago Bulls in the playoff. And every now and then you'd hear the sports, Michael Jordan, oh, yeah. And then our translator from Ukraine that we just gifted him with a brand new NIV study Bible. And he opened it up, and this is how he received it. I've never seen anything like this. I heard they existed, but I didn't know such a thing was possible to have. And we'd just given him that NIV study Bible, and he'd gone into his room. He'd come back into the motel room where most of the Americans were. He saw them gathered around a little TV they could hardly see on. And this is what he said. You Americans make me sick. You're watching a screen you can't even see, and you listen to a sportscaster you can't even understand, and you've got the Bible in front of you, you're not giving time to know its words. What's wrong with you Americans? When my father-in-law was a missionary in Russia, he said the problem he had with most of the American mission teams coming over to Russia was not with how much help they would give the Russian church. The problem he had to face was how much harm they would do the Russian church because he came over so weakly spiritually. People, it's time for us to step up to the plate. It's time to say, Lord Jesus, teach us to pray. Do what you must to get us on our knees and on our faces. Do what you must. Now, let's move on. John 15:7, Jesus said this. Again, this is the Upper Room Discourse, and he says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you can ask whatever you will and it'll be done for you. Is that not easy? Jesus says, find out what my word says, abide in me and let my words remain in you, and you can ask whatever you will and it'll be done. Really? That's what it says. Let's go even further. 1 John chapter 5, verse 14 and 15. 1 John, written by John the Apostle, whom Jesus loved. John says this. This is the confidence we have in him, that we know that he hears us if we ask anything according to his will. And if we know that he hears us, then we know that we have anything that we've asked. This is the confidence, this is the boldness, this is the brashness, that we know that we have what we've asked of him if we've asked according to his word. Now, how do you start this relationship? I want you to notice how Jesus teaches them. That's our last part here. He says, when you pray, say, Father. Now, if you go back to Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 through 14, he starts off, when you pray, say, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Okay? But he doesn't say our Father here, does he? The plural's not there. The who art in heaven isn't there. Our Father. That's the first start. Our Father. Personal. Not our, it's my Father. It's when you come into that prayer room, Dad, I got some things I don't understand, and I need help. Would you please show me what to do? This is the word for you today. He's not here to condemn you. He's not here to cast guilt and all sorts of stuff on you. He's here to deliver you from your prayerless condition and bring you close to himself. So start with this cry. Our Father, our team's going to lead us in one song at the end. I just want to ask you to do this. I believe God has ordered this time for your church. I believe God's ordered this time in our nation to call people back to prayer and repentance. So right now, this is God's invitation for you for just a moment. You start with this. Father, please teach me to pray. And as they lead us in this song, it's a heart cry from every believer across the ages that says, I need you. How I need you. As they're singing, if you want to just step out from where you are, you want to come down here at the front and kneel, you can do that. You can kneel at your place. I know for me, kneeling is hard because it's hard for me to get back off the floor at 65. But sometimes I kneel anyway. I want you to stand. I'm going to pray a prayer. They're going to lead us in a song, and let that song be the prayer of your heart. If God would lead you to make a public just statement that you're going to give your life to prayer, then you make your way down here in front and just kneel for a brief moment. It's a testimony to God and those here, I'm going to give my life to prayer. Father, would you work a movement of prayer in this church for the glory and honor of your fame and for the advancement of your gospel, we pray. Now you guys respond to God as he calls you.
Lord, I come and I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh God, how high. where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found, Lord, is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. Power, defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. Power, defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. 'Cause Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
As we close the service today, just for a moment, I want to ask you to do something. This is the way the nation of Israel expressed their dependence on God. When Nehemiah read the law from morning till noon, they stood up and they raised their hands as a sign that says, we're hungry for you, O God. We want you. We want you more than we want anything else. We're hungry for you. So we're going to sing this chorus, oh, I need you, how I need you. As we sing this, would you, I know it's not proper for lots of Baptist people to do this, but please trust me at this. Raise your hands and look to the sky and cry out to the Father and sing this song, Lord, I need you, how I need you. Let's do that together, would we?
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My defense, you are my righteousness.
Thank you for the heart of this church that's lifting their hands up right now, crying out to you, oh God, we need you. We cannot exist without you in this day. So Holy Spirit, would you fall on this church? Fall on all churches around here, God, that the Spirit of God may be visible to all and the gospel be advanced in these last days. Do not let us continue to commit the sin of prayerlessness. Make us a house of prayer. For the glory of Christ, we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask the team just to play quietly. I'm going to ask you just to exit quietly. If you want to stay here and pray, you want to linger, feel free to do that. time, may God might be speaking to some of you to do something different. So feel free to exit if God leads you. They're just going to play for just a few more moments. And you do business with God. You're dismissed.